Thank you so much for today. God, we thank you for another new day. God, we thank you for another opportunity for us to just gather together as the body and to just spend some time in worship and in the Word. Father, I ask you to just come and you would move and you work this morning, God, that this time, God, we give to you. It is yours for you to use. God, I just thank you so much that you who raised Christ from the grave, that you are at work in us today. The same power, the same might, the same victory that Christ has over sin and death, God, you have given to us, and you are using and working in us. God, we just ask you just continue doing what you have been doing. Continue working and moving and shaping and molding and removing. God, we just thank you so much for your work and how sufficient and good and mighty it is. God, I just ask you, just be with us today. God, you are who we are here to hear from, the one we are here to connect to. So we give you this time. We pray all this in your Son's precious and holy name. Amen. Amen. Well, good. So along with giving that update, just as we are continuing this month, we started this month and we're talking about and preparing for small groups. We've got small groups that are begin meeting here in the beginning of September. And small groups are a huge part of who we are and our plan moving forward as a church. From the very beginning, we wanted to clearly define what the wind was for us as a church. And while we have a heart to be a church and a community that everyone is welcome to come as you are, you come as you are. You don't have to dress up. You don't have to get fancy. You don't have to be anyone you aren't. You don't have to have your life more together than it is. Just come as you are. But that our goal is not to just be a gathering place, but that our goal is to be an equipping place. That we want to be a place that everyone is welcome to come and come as they are, but then when they come here, that they have interaction and a meeting with Jesus, and on the other side of the interaction and meeting with Jesus, that their hearts are changed and transformed, and that they begin a lifelong process of becoming more and more like Jesus. For us, our goal is not just to get a bunch of people in a room. It's not even to create a bunch of small groups. It's our win for us is we want to be a church that is successfully sending out missionaries, pastors, planters, and has leaders in the community who are leading people to faith on a consistent and regular basis. That's the win for us, is for us to successfully disciple people along in the process to where they become disciples who are making disciples. And a huge part of that process, we believe, is through groups, because it's in that group setting that we get to do life on life. And that is where the kind of consistent daily growth happens, that it is really hard to systematize. It's hard to make a curriculum that successfully disciples someone from a brand new Christian to being ready to go on missions. And rather, what we see practiced by Jesus and we see practiced by the other disciples is they invited people into relationship and they did life together. And so that is our goal and what we desire to do and what we desire to accomplish as a church and as a ministry. And so because of that, groups is extremely important for us. And so this month we've been kind of preparing and laying the heart and laying the foundation. And so we've been in this series called Abiding. And in week one, we started this looking at John 15, where this idea of abiding comes from, talking about how Jesus is the vine. You and I are the branches. What is the branch's job? The branch's job is to be connected to the vine. That's the branch's job. The branch's job is not to produce fruit. The branch's job is not to cut away and prune away what needs to be removed. The branch's job is abide in Christ. Our goal is to grow in greater intimacy and dependence on Christ. That is what we need to strive for. That is what our goal is. That is our heartbeat. And that by doing so, by abiding, by being connected to the vine, what the natural byproduct is that fruit will be produced in us. And then the Father, God, the vine dresser, he is going to cut away what needs to be removed when we are submitted and surrendered to his will and his plan. And so our goal is just abide, be connected. How we can encourage each other through this, because this is not a one-time decision, but a moment-by-moment decision that we have to make over and over and over again. Some moments are going to be easy. Some moments are going to be hard. Some moments we're going to choose to abide. We're going to choose to walk and live in the Spirit. Some moments we're not. We're going to choose to walk and live in the flesh. And so we need community to support and encourage us along the journey towards the same mission that we all started, so that Christ can finish the work that he started in us. So we started looking at John 15. Last week we talked about pruning and looked at just the example of us surrendering to God, laying things down that need to be laid down so that we might bear more fruit, that the goal of pruning is in preparing us to bear more fruit. And then this morning, as we continue this, here's what we're going to talk about today. I called the message this morning, Suffering Sucks. Suffering Sucks. We're going to talk about suffering today, because it is real, it is there, and it exists. Three of the most difficult seasons of my life have come within the last 4 and 5 years. Within the last 4 and 5 years, I have had three moments that have significantly impacted me. The first was divorce. The second was losing my father suddenly, and then the third is that Jess and I have struggled with infertility and miscarriages over the last 2.5 years. And so over these last 4 or 5 years, man, like there has been some really insane and crazy stuff that really just kind of rocked my world. The darkest for me was walking through divorce, that my world was turned upside down in less than a year, that I felt more anger, more hurt, more loss of direction than I ever had. For those of you who've heard my story, I've shared my story before, just that, man, like within the matter of like a couple of months, that I had lost the person that I thought I was going to spend the rest of my life with, lost a close friend, and I didn't think I was ever going to be in ministry again, that I thought I was done being a pastor. And so I felt like all of these things that felt concrete and certain and like I was going to have them for forever were all gone in a matter of moments. And so that was extremely difficult and challenging. And through that season, the one tattoo on my arm that I have that I've shared before, and I know you can't see it, so I'll just tell you what it is. There's a hand that's coming up out of water, and it's just the hand is it's just reaching up out of the water. And then there's a hand that's coming down from the clouds, and the hand coming down from the clouds has a hold of the hand coming out of the water. But the hand coming out of the water does not have a hold of the hand coming down from the clouds. Because the best way that I could describe it is I felt like everything that I had hold of that was concrete and certain and holding me in place was gone. And so I felt like I was just reaching up and like I had a hold of nothing, and then I was just like drifting into nothingness, and that the only reason that I know that I didn't is because through it all that God had a hold of me. I didn't have a hold of him, okay? Like, it wasn't. Like I didn't lose my faith. I didn't blame God. It wasn't anything like that. It was just like, there was just, I did not feel like I had a grasp of anything that was protecting me. And that the only reason that I know that I'm here today, that I give all of the glory to God, that God is who kept a hold of me through it all, that I give God the glory that I'm still me today. I give God the glory that I get to be up here preaching and pastoring today. That I give God the glory for the amazing woman that I get to do life with now, my wife Jess, that he gets the glory through all of it. I also think that it's important to note that through that season, as well as through the sudden loss of my dad, who was just, he was one of the most important people in my spiritual life and in life, because he's my dad. He was who I wanted to grow up to be like. He was the pastor that I strived to be like. He was the one who taught me and helped me explore and walk through my call to ministry. And he was the first phone call that I make any time that I had a question about life or ministry. And so to lose that and to lose it just like it wasn't, like, he wasn't sick. He wasn't ill. It was just, he was just gone. That through that season, and then also for Jess and I now, as we have battled with miscarriages and battled with infertility, that in all of those situations, I have never walked through them alone. That through each and every single one of those circumstances, that I have had community that was around me, that while God gets the glory because it's only by God's power and by his work, that there was community around me that has loved and supported and walked with me through each and every single one of those. And without that community, I do not know how things would have unfolded. That without my parents, as I was walking through my divorce, I don't know. I don't know. I don't know where I would have gone. I don't know what I would have done. That they were very much a rock and an anchor for me in that season, and I'm extremely grateful for them. That walking through losing my dad, that there are some of you who are here, that you have been part of our community, and that you were here praying for and supporting me and our family as we walked through that, and that some of you here in the room, that you have prayed and supported and asked and encouraged Jess and I as we have walked through infertility now. And so I know for certain, because of personal experience, the impact that community can have as you and I walk through suffering. Because it's important for us to know that as we seek to abide, as we grow in deeper intimacy and greater reliance on Christ, abiding is not a protection from suffering. Abiding does not protect us from suffering. It does not keep it from happening. Suffering still happens. Loss still happens. Hurt still happens. Pain still happens. But whenever you and I are abiding, and when you and I are abiding together, I believe it can significantly change how you and I walk through that suffering. It can significantly change the impact that the suffering can have, and that is changed by our abiding. And it involves us doing it together. And so this is what we're going to talk about today, is we're going to talk about the significant impact that abiding can have as you and I are walking through suffering. And then we're going to talk about how this ties into us going through life together and doing life together in groups. And so our passage this morning, 2 Corinthians chapter 4. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, and we are starting in verse 7 this morning. So this is Paul's second letter to the church in Corinth. We kind of pick up in the middle of a section, and so I'm going to give you a little bit of context after I read this first verse. But this is what it says in verse 7. It says, "But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us." So Paul starts this section. He's continuing on from a thought that he was continuing earlier on in chapter 4. And he's going through and he's talking about ministry, his ministry. And he's, as he has often had to do, he is defending that his ministry that he is preaching, the gospel that he is sharing, is not one that he made, but it was one he received. And that his call to ministry is not just Paul woke up one day and was like, "Hey, I'm going to go and be a missionary and I'm going to plant churches all over the Mediterranean." That he was called by God to do what he's doing. And so he's like, "I want you to know this is not just me speaking, that this is God who has given me this message. This is his message and this is his call." And as he's talking about this, right, he goes through and he talks about the light of Christ, the light of Christ. And so he says, "We have received the light of Christ." What is the light of Christ? The light of Christ is the good news, is the gospel, that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, came and lived a perfect life, the life that you and I could not live, perfectly fulfilling all the law, all the scriptures. And then at the end of his life, he chose to lay his life down, being crucified on the cross for your sins and mine. He was treated like you and I deserve to be treated. The wrath of God was poured out on him so that the righteousness of God could be poured out on you and I, that we could be redeemed and in right standing with God because of what Christ has done. That is the good news, that is the gospel, that it's not by our works, by our effort, but it is by the finished work on the cross that you and I can accept, receive, and stand in good grace and good standing before God Almighty. That is the light that you and I carry, that is the hope, that elsewhere in Scripture it talks about how you and I, we are called to always be ready to give an example, to give truth and point to the hope that we have, the hope that we have in Christ. So this is the light. The light is the gospel. The light is the treasure in the jar of clay is the light of Christ. It is his lordship and his glory in us. It is his fruit that is in us. And so Paul says, he says, "But we have this treasure. We have this treasure, and it is in jars of clay." Jars of clay. Weak, fragile clay jars. That is what the treasure is in. Now, they would often use clay jars to store things. Like, this was a common tool. They would use clay jars in order to store their wine. They would use it to store oil. They would use it to store grain. And they would even, sometimes, people, if they were afraid that someone was going to try and break in their house and steal their fancy and nice things, that sometimes they would store their treasures in clay jars. Because the clay jar is not clear that, like, that's what would be in it, right? Like, it's not that you would look at a clay jar and be like, "I believe that clay jar makes me think there's something really important in that jar." No, it's like hiding things in plain sight. It's insignificant, right? And so you would hope that they would just kind of pass by and not look in the clay jar and see all your fancy belongings. But Paul very specifically, he uses this idea of this earthen vessel, this clay jar, to talk about what it is that is contained and what is containing what is contained. This treasure is intentionally in these clay weak jars, that a clay container is not very strong, right? It doesn't take a whole lot of force to break a clay dish, to break pottery. You don't have to try very hard. And so it's fragile, it's weak, it's unassuming, like it's not necessarily fancy. You don't look at it and be like, "Ooh, wow, amazing." And then Paul goes so far to say, he's like, it's in clay jars intentionally, that this power that we have, this treasure that we have, is in jars of clay intentionally, so that there can be no confusion where the power, where the significance comes from. That the power is not in the vessel, the power is what is in the vessel. The power is in God in us, not in us. The fruit that we've been talking about, the result of abiding, the fruit is from God in us, not from us. That you and I, we are the vessel. We are the clay vessel. And while I love you and you are created in the image of God, which gives you value and purpose, apart from Christ, hear me, we're worthless. We're worthless. You and I are created specifically for one function, to live and walk in unity with God. That is our purpose, to worship and glorify Him. That is why we are made. And so when we accept that identity and we live and we walk out that identity, there is an incredible treasure that is in us. But if you take the treasure away, we're just an empty clay pot. Just as in John 15, where Jesus said, the branch that is disconnected from the vine, it withers and dies. Apart from Christ, we are missing it. We miss it. We miss our reason for being here. We miss our reason for being created, that you and I were created to be vessels, and that our significance comes not from us, but from who is in us. The other night I was out walking, and it was kind of late, and I was walking down the street. So because it was kind of late, there was not a ton of traffic on the road, and I walked past a transformer. And as I was walking past the transformer, I was like kind of shocked because how loud the electrical hum was from the transformer. I mean, it was like deafening because it was so quiet. It was just like, I was like, man, this is kind of crazy. And so I was kind of excited and just like kind of like stood there and just listened to it for a little while. It fascinated me. And it's so boring, right? Like, this sounds so stupid. But I was fascinated, okay? I was fascinated by like this humming. I was like, man, that's just so cool. Because I've seen videos. Have you ever seen those videos where the people use like coils to make the electricity like make songs? Because you can, by altering the voltage, it changes the frequency of sound waves that it creates as it passes through the air, which changes the octave of sounds, and so you can literally make electricity play music. It's crazy. It's so cool. The first time I saw it was in this really stupid movie called The Sorcerer's Apprentice. It has Nicolas Cage and then Jay Baruchel. You know, he always plays like the super awkward guy. He's always like, right? So he like plays this nerdy guy who's doing this experiment trying to make it make electricity play sound. And there's this one part in the movie where he does it, and it's like playing this whole, it's the song by Owl City. I was like, man, that's so cool. And then I found out that that was actually real. That wasn't just movie. Like, you can actually do that. And I was like, man, that's so cool. And so I was staying there. I'm like, man, I'm getting to see this in person. This is kind of cool. And obviously, it wasn't changing pitch and octave, and it wasn't playing songs. There may have been songs going on in my head, but that was all me. So like, I'm standing there, I'm listening to it, and then I had this thought, and I was like, man, like, it's just so crazy. It's so crazy, because, like, I'm standing here, and I'm hearing the hum, and I see the transformer, and I hear the hum, and I'm like, man, that's really cool that the transformer is doing that. But if you were to take and disconnect that transformer from the main power supply, there's no hum. It's gone. There's no hum. That what I look at and what I see is I see the lines and I see the coils and I can hear the hum. But what's making the hum is the electricity in the lines, in the coils, not the lines and the coils themselves. And I was like, this is it. Like, this is us. This is us and God. That you and I, on our own, we're just a bunch of like wires and coils. And unless you connect us to electricity, we don't serve a whole lot of function and purpose. But as soon as you do, some kind of really cool sciencey stuff can happen. You connect it to the power. Not only is it supplying power, but then there's evidence of the power of the work that is happening in the wire and through the coils, in the same way that once you and I connect, once you and I abide, whenever you and I recognize we are vessels and we are vessels meant to contain the light of Christ, that when we receive that and we walk in that and we live in that, then what people around us get to see is they get to see the power of Christ at work within us. And it gives significance and it gives fulfillment and it gives purpose to our lives. Greater and more beautiful than anything we could do on our own. We are vessels. Paul continues in verse 8. He says, we are afflicted in every way, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not driven to despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be manifested in our bodies. As vessels who are filled with the treasure of Christ, that is the assumption that Paul makes here. These next verses, they don't just apply to just everyone. These are not, this is not like the promise for every human being who lives, okay? This is a promise for all those who are in Christ, all those who have Christ in them, who are the vessels who have received the treasure, who have the treasure in them, all those who have the treasure in them. These are the promises. We are afflicted in every way. There is no way that you and I are not going to experience pain, hurt, or struggle. Are you and I limited? Do you and I experience pain and hurt? Do we struggle with things? Yes. But we are not crushed. It will not overtake you. Are we perplexed? Are we confused? Do we misunderstand? Do we often wonder, why, God, why are you doing this? Why is this happening? Yes. But we are not without hope. Are we attacked because of our faith? Yes, Jesus promised we would be. But God does not leave us alone in it. Just as he was with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the furnace, so is he with you and I every step of the way. Are you and I going to be knocked down? Notice that this is not tripped. This is like an intentional leak. You got pushed on your butt. Yes. Yes, we will be. But that is not the end. That is not the end. Over and over throughout our lives, day by day, you and I live out and experience the death of Christ, the cost of salvation, the brokenness of this present world, the weakness of our flesh, and the pain that comes as a result of our broken world. But as we experience the death, we also experience his life. But it's not the end of the story. It's not where things are left. You and I can experience suffering, but it's not the end. And so in this, for all those who are vessels that are full of Christ, what is this? Vessels that are full of Christ withstand the pressure. Vessels that are full of Christ withstand the pressure. He says, all those who have the light of Christ in them, even though we are jars of clay, okay, jars of clay don't withstand anything. You can't put any weight on them, right? It's like this aluminum can, okay? So I've got this aluminum can. I've got two aluminum cans, okay? Same brand of soda. They're literally from the same package, okay? Same aluminum quality, made in the same place, packaged together, sold together, okay? Exact same. They're the exact same container. However, there's a big difference between these two things. One of them is empty. One of them is full. Whenever you and I are empty and pressure comes, crushes. Whenever we are full, same container, same pressure, not crushed. What's the difference? Is this can of Coke just better than this can of Coke? Do you think that this can of Coke just did better things? It just was, this aluminum can was just, it took care of its life better. It just made all the right choices. It was always kind of good to people. I know what it is. This can of Coke probably just memorized more verses of scripture than this one. That's probably what happened. No. The difference is this one is full. It is what is in the can that allows this can to stand up against the weight and the pressure that this can did not have. Vessels that are full of Christ withstand the pressure. It's not that there's not going to be pressure, okay?
you know how much more fun my job would be if I got to stand up here and be like, hey, follow Jesus, and then everything is going to be awesome the rest of your life. You're going to have all the money that you need. All of your relationships are going to be amazing all the time. Everyone at work is just going to love you. You're going to get along with all your neighbors really, really well. Every venture or thing that you try, you're just going to succeed and flourish at all the days of your life. It'd be a lot of fun, but it wouldn't be true. Afflicted in every way, but not crushed. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Perplexed, but not driven to despair. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying the death of Jesus so that his life might be made manifest in our lives. The power of Christ in us is on display. Vessels that are full of Christ withstand the pressure. Paul continues in verse 11. He says, for we who live are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus may also be manifested in our mortal flesh. So death is at work in us, but life in you. Since we have the same spirit of faith according to what has been written, I believed and so I spoke. We also believe and so we also speak. Knowing that he who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and bring us with you into his presence. For it is all for your sake, so that as grace extends to more and more people, it may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. For those of us who are in Christ, who are vessels full of his light, we are constantly surrendering our lives. This is Galatians 2:20. I have been crucified in Christ, that I no longer live, but the life I now live, I live by faith in Jesus Christ, right? That we lay down our lives, and the life I now live is not mine. We are constantly having to, right? It's not like we talked about last week. It's not just a one-time surrender. It is a moment-by-moment constantly surrendering, either submitting and seeking to follow right behind the Spirit, like we talked about last week, right in his footsteps, right behind him, or we choose to walk in flesh. It is a constant over our lives. We are constantly having to surrender ourselves, lay ourselves down, that it's no longer I, but Christ who lives. We are constantly surrendering ourselves so that Christ is now seen in us. He is now seen in us. That by surrendering and laying down my life, Christ, the hope, is that Christ is now seen in me by those who are around me. That both through the surrendering of ourselves and our walking through suffering, this can lead to life in others. Here Paul says, he says, it is death in us, but life in you. What's he talking about? He's talking about suffering and pain and hurt. Do you know that Paul had to go through some serious stuff throughout his ministry? At one point in time, things got so bad that Paul heard about an assassination attempt on his life, and so he had to be lowered over a wall in a basket in order to escape a city. More than once, Paul had to flee a city because he was being chased down. Rocks and stones were being thrown at him. And ultimately, Paul's ministry ends up costing him his life after living in prison for many years. And so Paul's like, all of this suffering and all this hurt, it's for you. It's for you. It's for you, church. He says, because the same God of the psalmist who says, I believe and so I speak, we believe and so speak, the same power that raised Jesus from the dead will also raise us and bring us into his presence. And he says, and this cost, whatever the cost is for the growth of the kingdom and God's glory, it's worth it. It's worth it. Withstanding the pressure brings others to Christ. That only by being full of Christ are we able to withstand the pressure. And that by withstanding the pressure, that others might be brought to Christ. Why? Well, because the more that I've stood on this can, the more evidence and signs of stress there are on the can. You see, suffering leaves marks. Suffering leaves marks. But there's a seriously different outcome. And so what happens is you and I, all day long, all week long, are walking around a bunch of people that are walking around like this. Just crushed. Hopeless. And they've gone through some of the same things that you've gone through. And then they meet you, and maybe they get a chance to hear your story and what you've, and then they say, why? How are you okay? Like, why are you not angry all the time? I am angry all the time. Don't you know that life is just against us? Like, there's all these people that they're just going to serve themselves. They're going to do whatever they want. And there's evil, wicked people that have all these things. And we're here just barely scraping by. Like, why are you not mad? My hope isn't here. Where does your hope come from? Why hasn't this destroyed you? Man, if I had gone through what you went through, I don't think I would make it. Well, I didn't. But he and me did. And can I tell you something? The same power that's in me is available to you. That you don't have to be this anymore either. Because while I can't do it, it'd be really cool if I found a way to like make this back into a full-size can and like fill it and seal it. That'd be a really cool illustration. As impossible as that is for me to do now, it's impossible in our power, but not in his. Because the truth is that all of us, we start out this way. And it's only by his work, his healing, that we were repaired and filled and then able to stand the same pressure that once crushed us. In the same way that whenever you look at a tree, if you ever have like a large tree that gets blown over in a storm, and you look at the root system, sometimes with large trees, what can happen is that if the tree, as it is growing as a sapling, if it is not under consistent pressure from wind, its roots will grow out wide, but not down deep. Because it's actually the wind blowing on the sapling at a consistent rate that encourages the tree to grow its roots down deep. It's the pressure. It's the pressure that encourages the depth. In the same way, it is the pressure that can become our greatest witness. Because while we can go through the same things as others around us who aren't in Christ, the impact is significantly different. And the result is another thing all on its own. That elsewhere, Paul talks about in Romans, he says that we are to actually consider it all joy when we face suffering of any kind. Because suffering produces endurance, endurance produces character, and character leads to hope. So Paul's like, not only can you get through suffering, but God is going to take your suffering and use it to turn you into someone who's even greater. Withstanding suffering, withstanding the pressure brings others to Christ. Paul closes out the section we're reading this morning, verse 16. He says, so we do not lose heart. Though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this light, momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. As we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. Paul says, so no matter what, it does not matter what life or the enemy tries to throw at you. We will not lose heart. We will not lose heart. That even as our bodies are slowly decaying, because here's a fun, happy, fluffy thought for you this morning. From the moment that you and I are born, we are just slowly moving towards decay and death. Like from the moment you are born, you are just falling apart slowly over time until one day, finally, you fall apart completely. But Christ in you is doing the exact opposite. That day by day, he is renewing you from the inside. That day by day, he is taking and removing that which is dead and replacing it with that which is alive. that day by day he is taking away the things in us that are not of him, that are not from him, that are not good for us, that are not good for those who are around us, and he's replacing them with good things, things of him, things that bring life. And so while each day that you and I wake up, we might be closer and closer to the last day we wake up, each day we wake up is also the promise that I can be more today like Christ than I was yesterday, because his work in me renews day by day. Our inner self is being renewed, even though our bodies are falling apart. The work of Christ in us is bringing healing and new life. And he says that this light, have you ever described your suffering as light? Like, have you ever been in the middle of a really crappy time? You've just been like, this is nothing, bro. No, none of us, right? Every single one of us, when we got stuff going on, this is the worst thing that's ever happened. It starts so far back, right? Like if you've got teenagers in your house and they go through a breakup and it's like, I'm never gonna love again. And as an adult, you're just like, you have no idea what love even is. But then as an adult, your car like doesn't start one morning. Oh my gosh, the world is gonna end. Why, right? We like all feel like Job, like we're just under constant attack of why, Lord, why? Paul says this light, momentary affliction. The other thing about our suffering is we also think it lasts forever. When is this going to end? When am I going to get through this season? I'm so tired of dealing with this. When are things going to get easier? I'm still waiting for that day, by the way, the day when things slow down. You know that comment of, yeah, we're busy right now, but here pretty soon things will slow down. Lies! Lies! I feel the same way about suffering. It's like, one day this stuff is going to get easier, and it's just like it doesn't ever feel like it's going to. And Paul's like, but this is nothing. Even if you and I were to suffer for years and years and years and years and years, that it is a moment. That the light and momentary burden, pain, and suffering is preparing us for the eternal weight of glory to which there is no comparison. And so we keep heart by looking not at what is seen, but what is unseen. Not looking what is seen, but what is unseen. What is unseen? Jesus is what is unseen. Because he is the visible of the invisible. He is the literal manifestation of God. He is God with us, Emmanuel. It is divine. It is to fixate our mind, our attention, and our eyes on the vine. And to say, you know what? It does not matter what else is going on around me. If I've got you, I'm good. If I've got you, I'm good. So we abide. We abide. By abiding, we don't lose heart. By abiding, we are vessels that are full. By being vessels that are full, we can withstand the pressure. By being vessels that are able to withstand the pressure, we become a great beacon of hope and light to the world. So we abide. But whatever you and I suffer here and now cannot and will not ever compare to what we have gained through Christ. That what we suffer here and now is light compared to the weight of his glorious presence. That the length of time we suffer is a blink of the eye compared to eternity with him. So we must abide, because we cannot allow the things that are seen to become more important in our hearts and our minds than the things that are unseen. That we cannot allow the suffering to become more important than Christ in our lives. Now I say all of this saying and affirming, grief is still necessary. You still need to feel the emotion and the weight and the loss that is healthy and that is necessary. Christ grieved. You and I should grieve. to allow ourselves, and we cannot over-spiritualize, and by spiritualizing things, dismiss the reality of pain. But there's a fine line, as with everything, that there is a line of allowing ourselves to feel and grieve, and then there is living in it and allowing it to consume you. And that's what we can't have. Because even as you and I grieve, as Paul says, we don't grieve as those who do not know. Right? Even when we grieve the loss of loved ones, we don't grieve them the same way. Why? Because we know this isn't it. This is not the end. There is an eternal hope. We have to fix our eyes, keep our focus, and be reminded of our true hope. So as you and I remember that we are just vessels, not meant to be the strength and power, but filled with the one who is, that through that we can withstand so much, that through our withstanding we can counsel and encourage others, even bringing those who are not in Christ to Christ. By keeping eyes on him, by abiding, we can keep the main thing. And finally, praise God that you and I are not meant to do this alone. Christ is the power. He is the hope. He is the way. Abiding in him is the answer. That is the only answer. You can't take Christ out of the equation and then fill that with people. It doesn't work. But with Christ at the center and community around to encourage and remind us to go back to the center when we begin to drift, and we all need it because we all drift. That's our great hope. That's the purpose and the function of the church, which is why Paul, in his first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 12, verse 25, he says that there may be no division in the body, but that the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. The context of this passage is Paul is talking about spiritual gifting and God bringing the body of Christ together, talking about how we're like a body with many parts, many members, but one body in unison under Christ, that when we are doing this right, when we are united, not because we're all similar, not because we're all alike, not because we all think the same way, or because we all like the same things, or because we all like the same sports teams, that we're united by our hope in Christ and our hope in Christ alone. That when we are doing this well, we're doing this right, we're united in such a way that there is no division in the body, but that when one member suffers, we all suffer together. And when one member is honored, we're all honored. We abide together. We abide together. And so that's my encouragement for you today, is that as you are planning out your fall and you're coordinating your schedule and you're committing to what's important and what you can go without, let me just encourage you that whether or not you're here this morning and you're in a rough spot, and some of you may be. You may be in the middle of a season that you would call suffering. You may be in here this morning and things are great and you're in a great spot in life, and I am so extremely happy for you, and praise God, because life is cycles. We're not always suffering. We're not always great. Sometimes we're in the middle and sometimes we're on either extreme end. Regardless of where you are at, whether things are great or things aren't great right now, I encourage you to get in that community. And for us, man, our heart behind this is we just want to create the opportunity, okay? We're not saying that this is the answer to everything. We're not saying that our groups are perfect. We're not saying that only through an Axiom group can you have biblical community. But some of you here this morning, you may be new, and you're not even sure whether or not Axiom is going to be your home. I'm glad you're here. We're happy to have you. And if you feel like this is the place that God has for you, then we are so extremely excited for you to be here, be part of our church. If it's not here, my hope and prayer for you is that you find the church that is, and that you plug in there, regardless of how that looks for them. That you surround yourself with community that actually knows you and has an opportunity to talk about life and what's going on, to encourage and support you, to be present with you, to suffer with you when you suffer, and to celebrate with you when you celebrate. Because while the answer is Christ and the hope is only found through him being in us, through his spirit being present in us, that we are still imperfect, and it is still a day by day, moment by moment. It is so easy to drift. And so to have friends, family who is around, to act as a corral and a protector, and for you to do the same for them, to encourage each other towards greater intimacy and dependence in Christ. That's the goal. That's the hope. So if you're looking for that, please don't leave today without checking out and signing up for a group, because we would love for you to find that here. I'm going to pray, and then we're going to worship. Back at the beginning of summer, we switched our service. We haven't always done it this way, but we really, really like doing it this way, to where we do the message at the beginning and worship after, rather than worship being a preparation for the message, becoming a response. And so my encouragement for you is that as we sing these songs, just keep your mind present. Don't wander. Stick around. And just allow the Spirit to continue working. That this would be a response to whatever it is that the Lord spoke to you today. We have communion at the front as well as in the back for you to come and take as you feel led. But as we take, man, we are being reminded of the death of Christ, and the resurrection, and the life that is in Christ. We are taking as a form of unity, as a sign that we are in this together. We are part of the same body, saved by the same sacrifice, serving the one King. So however you need to respond this morning, I just encourage you to utilize this time to respond, that the Lord would settle into your heart whatever he had for you today. So let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, I just thank you. God, I thank you first and foremost, God, that you are faithful. God, I thank you and I praise you that we can rely and we can trust in you. God, I thank you that the sacrifice that Christ made is sufficient, that we might be forgiven and restored. I thank you for the work of the Spirit that is in us. I ask you, just continue pruning what needs to be pruned, growing what needs to be grown. Father, that in myself and all those who are with us this morning, God, that more and more of you would be produced and found in us. Father, I just lift up anyone who is here this morning who is in a challenging season, who's struggling. God, I ask that you would just meet them in this moment. God, that you would just surround them, remind them that they are not alone, that you are present with them in the battle, that you are great and mighty, that mighty is the Lord, that he is the leader of angel armies, that there is nothing that is greater than you. Fill them with your peace, the peace that goes beyond what we can see in our circumstances, that can't be explained. God, surround them. Surround them with people who love them and encourage them, that might help keep them on the right path. God, for all those who are here this morning, things are great right now. God, we thank you, we praise you. We thank you for your provision, because God, we know that you provide all things. God, I just ask that in this season that they would just celebrate you. They would praise you. They would acknowledge that you are the source. You are the one who this is from. And God, I just ask you would just continue to remind us of our need of you. Father, that you would be the main thing, not just the main thing for our Sunday, but the main thing for everything. Father, we just take a moment and we just pray over a new school year that is getting ready to start this year. We just pray for all the teachers and all the students who are getting ready to go back. God, we just ask you to just give them an incredible first week of school. Yes, you just give them an amazing year. We pray for protection over our schools, protection over our teachers, over our students. And God, we ask that you would do a work there. God, do a work in our schools. Do a work in our students. Father, all this we ask in Jesus' mighty and holy name. Amen.
One God. God with a thousand names. You've shown up a thousand ways. And your character has never changed. Can't control. Afflictions eclipsed by glory, just how beautiful you are right now. Each your affections are for me. Oh, how he loves us so. So a shout of praise to our King in this room.
Amen. Well, if you guys want to take a seat just real quick, if this is your first time with us, just thank you so much for coming today. I know it can be intimidating sometimes coming somewhere new, and so we appreciate you coming and joining us. I hope you felt welcomed, and we are so glad that you're here today. Before you leave, if you want to stop by the connection corner on your way out, it's just the back corner in that area that's got the coffee and stuff. Fill out a connection card for us. Every first-time guest that fills out a connection card, checks the first-time guest box, we actually choose a ministry every year that serves our area to donate to, and so this year we donate $5 to Shelter House for every first-time card that's filled out in your honor. So if you stop by, fill out the card, we'd love to donate to them on your behalf. It's just a way of saying thank you so much for filling that card out with us. If it's your second time with us, you come out and fill the card out, check that second time box, and then we have a gift for you. It's a free drink coupon to Boomerang Coffee Lounge here in Midland. It's just over there on the circle. Amazing coffee place, great coffee, great baked goods. If you've never been, we would love to introduce you, and if you're familiar, then you know how awesome it is, and we would love for you to get a free cup of coffee on us as just our way of saying thanks for coming back. Glad that you stuck around and gave us a second shot. We have kind of lots of things that are kind of kicking off as we get back to school, men's ministry, women's ministry, youth ministry. The best way to kind of stay up to date on all of that is to sign up for our newsletter. We have a newsletter that goes out every Friday with updates of all the upcoming events. We also have a sheet of paper at the connection corner you can grab. It's got upcoming dates for things coming. So I just encourage you, if you're not receiving that, if you're here, Axiom is your home, I encourage you to sign up for the newsletter. So you get that information sent right to you, but you can also grab that card. The announcement I want to leave you guys with, as I said during the message, we got small groups kicking off here in September. Come back to the connection corner, scan the QR code, see what group would work for you. But this last week, we actually filmed a video with some of our leaders, just as a way to introduce you guys to them, so you know them, and you can put their kind of their story to their face. And so we have our first small group leaders we're going to share with you this morning. So if you guys want to watch this video.
Hi, I'm Cassie Kramer, and this is my husband, Doug.
Hello.
We are facilitating a book study, Sacred Marriage, on Friday nights in our home from 6:30 to 8:30.
Well, my three people, I mean, the first one would obviously be Jesus, in my opinion, and it would be great to have him there. The second one would be Ben Franklin, just because it's an interesting person that I'd like to get to know better. And the third, it's kind of strange, but it would be Fats Domino, because I've always loved his music, and just, I would like to get to know him better.
I have to go with the obvious, God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. Can you imagine being in a room with the three of them? Gonna start with vanilla. Let's build our ice cream together, honey.
Oh.
So let's start with vanilla.
And you jumble like toppings on top, is that good?
Like maybe some rich caramel layers going through it.
Because I was thinking Rocky Road myself.
Some nuts for you,
yeah,
for sure.
Yeah. Maybe an otter, because they're so playful and fun. They just love being with each other. And if you ever see a family bothers together, that's why I kind of want for our groups to teach, basically.
Yeah, we want you to come as you are. Yeah. We love you just where you are right now, and we're excited to walk out this next leg of the journey with you. It is my everything.
Now just going short and sweet, Jesus loves, and that's what it's all about. I'm Doug Kramer.
And I'm Cassie. Yeah.
Woo. We've got some absolutely amazing group leaders for you to connect with. And so I encourage you just to see what spot works for you. Maybe if you're a couple here and you're interested in doing that sacred marriage study, then maybe Doug and his wife are going to be the leaders for you. So, but come by the connection corner, stop by, say hello, fill out the card. All the information that you need is back there. And then last for us today, if you do call Axiom home, as we had shared this morning, our update, Man, when you give to Axiom, you help us do so many different things. And so for all those who call Axiom home, if that is the way you want to participate in the service today, then you know there's several different ways you can do that, online, in person, or through the Tithely app. And just thank you so much to everyone who does. We are extremely thankful and grateful for all of you who partner with us in that. Without you, we wouldn't be able to do anything that we get to do. So thank you so much. Let me pray for us as we go. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for this time that we have together. God, we thank you for meeting us here, for working and moving. Holy Spirit, we ask you just go with us now. Continue the work that you started this morning. Continue shaping us, molding us more into the image of your Son. Be with us this week as we go and bring us all together again safely. Father, we thank you so much for your Son, for his finished work on the cross. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Thank you guys. Have a great week.